Welcome to The Big Fight. I'm Nidhi Razdan. This entire week, India has witnessed widespread protests by ordinary folk, students, celebrities, politicians, civil society in city after city against the Citizenship Amendment Bill, or the Act now, and the NRC. Many of these protests have been peaceful, where thousands of people have gathered to express their dissent. But yes, some of them have also turned violent, like in parts of Gujarat, several towns in UP, particularly today, as well as Mangalore. The government is clearly not happy, which is why we saw prohibitory orders or Section 144 imposed in many different cities since yesterday. We saw hundreds of protesters, many of them peacefully expressing their concerns, who were being rounded up by police and then detained for several hours before they were released. Broadband internet or mobile internet has been shut down in cities, in large parts of Lucknow, Agra and Ghaziabad, for instance, and then in Mangalore as well, in Assam. It was restored on Friday after 10 days because of court orders. In Kashmir, by the way, mobile and broadband internet has now been shut for 138 days after the revocation of Kashmir's special status. Now, all of this begs the question, is the Indian state intolerant of dissent? By all means, the state must go after those who break the law and indulge in violence. But what we have seen instead throughout this week has been a crackdown on peaceful protesters as well. Why is the world's largest democracy so touchy about criticism? Should a strong, confident nation deal with dissent differently? That's what we're asking on The Big Fight. And I'd like to introduce our panel and go straight across. First, to Zeeshan Ayub, actor joining us from Mumbai this evening. And Zeeshan, I'd like you to make the opening comments, because one of the things we have seen in these past few days is how celebrities from the film fraternity, who normally feel timid to speak out on these issues, have really been front and center of voicing their concerns and the way with protesters were dealt with. I want to hear first from you tonight, Zeeshan, on what you think of these nationwide protests today.
I think it is a very important part, a very important thing for our democracy, because I think it's really saddening for our secular fabric, the way things are coming out. So I think it was everybody's duty to come out and talk about it. And I'm really glad that it's like the whole India is standing together against the CAA now.
All right. Well, Zeeshan, those are your opening comments. I'll take 1 minute opening comments from the panelists here in the studio, and I'll begin with Yamini Aiyar, the president of the Center for Policy Research. Yamini Aiyar, is the state intolerant of dissent, or is the fact that people are protesting showing that it is tolerant of dissent?
Well, the state as an entity has a monopoly over violence. And the question about of how the state uses the its monopoly over violence is a testament to the nature of democracy. The fact is that the Indian state traditionally, and it's not unique to this particular moment, has tended always to use its monopoly over violence in times when it is insecure. Today is a very good example just of that. But India holds on to its democracy, and it holds on to its democracy very closely and very dearly, which is why you see every time the state pushes the envelope and uses violence, people come out on the streets to protect their rights. So this is both a testament to democracy as well as a recognition of a state that is somewhat insecure and is using its monopoly over violence in the worst ways possible.
Bhumika Saraswati is standing next to you. She's a master's student from Jamia. And Bhumika, what are your first comments? This began with the protest in Jamia and the police crackdown there, and it's become so much bigger. What do you think today?
I'd like to start saying I would like to bring the attention back on the 13th, not on the 15th. The 15th is what we all saw on the television when the Delhi police invaded our campus. But on the 13th, when we were protesting peacefully just outside of our university gates, and no more far away from our university gate, the police threw tear gas from outside within the university campus. And that, if that is how state responds to dissent, I'm sorry, but this is not our way and this is not how we want to see India.
You seem pretty traumatized by it even now.
Because my friends have gone back home.
They don't want to come back to campus right now?
My campus is no longer safe for all of us. It's barren. There's nobody. People of the hostels have left back. It doesn't look like a university, because they made it a war zone. Believe me, it's very traumatizing. They really made it a war zone. I mean, you can't throw away tear gas inside of our universities like that. My friends, their parents called them back. I live in Delhi. So I am here, I'm speaking on behalf of my friends. My friend Afreen, my friend Sambreen, my friend Ishita, they were calling me. They were inside of the washrooms locked. They were like, can somebody help us? Can somebody help us? We can't go help them because the metro stations are blocked. Huh, that's one more thing. Whenever something happens, you first thing you do is you lock away all the metro stations. You bring down the internet. My friends are locked inside. I can't go save them. I can't go by the roads because the roads are also blocked. The only thing I could do that day was go to ITO to protest. And like, you should believe me, all of you should actually go to my campus and see what they've done. And I don't think so they've ever entered any university campus the way they've entered our campus. Like, they didn't have permissions, they just came, they just went till the extent they had to go. And I still have voice messages of my friends calling me up, telling me, you know, we're stuck in the washroom, you know, we're in the library, they're coming here, what do we do? And then you have no messages from them. And one of my friends who had nothing to do with the protest was detained. Can you believe that? He was, and in the end, they had to leave him because he was not involved.
I'm sorry that you've had to go through that, Bhumika. And I am sorry about that. And we're going to talk about this in some more detail. Rajat Sethi is standing next to you. Rajat, you've heard this sort of an anguished student from Jamia standing next to you. A lot of the protesters are like Bhumika, okay? Of course, there are people who have indulged in violence. The state must deal with them. It is not acceptable. Arson is not acceptable. Stone throwing on police officers and policemen is not acceptable. But what about the people who were standing in Bangalore yesterday when Ram Guha, for instance, was picked up? What was he doing? He was talking about Ambedkar and he was talking about the Constitution. There were people like Bhumika who were peacefully standing and voicing their dissent. What is the state afraid of?
Well, Nidhi, first of all, it's not something which should happen in our nation. The rights of the student protesters is paramount and is non-negotiable. I fully stand with her, but let me also tell you, and we had this discussion also, what happened in Jamia was rather unfortunate, and few people who were miscreants who tried to hijack the whole movement from the student who were protesting predominantly non-violently, they wanted to take away the message and they wanted to take it to the streets. They wanted to make it unsafe. And they wanted to elicit a certain aspect of responses from the Delhi police so as to make the whole movement violent. And these are the same people who entered the campus, and the police, whose ultimate responsibility is also to maintain law and order, had to intervene in the matter in a rather unfortunate way, but nonetheless, saving lives of individuals is of paramount importance as well. So keeping this in mind, largely speaking, Section 144, which is imposed in such situation, though it sounds draconian when you are not party to it, but please keep it in mind that they are out there to protect the lives and the property of people, because at the end of the day, who is going to take the responsibility if they don't intervene at the right time with the right set of rules?
Why did they have to tear gas the library?
No,
I can understand, of course, the police has a responsibility to make sure that nobody is hurt and nobody dies, and you hear arguments in the name of security that are put out all the time. Yes, and one agrees with that to some extent. But students who were in the library that day, who were studying, were tear gassed.
Yeah, so you should ask the PRO of the Delhi police also about this. But I'm pretty sure that there would be some tangible, prima facie suspects who would be there. I mean, who knows that there were a set of miscreants. We all agree with that. And I'm sure you would also agree, who were trying to take advantage of the situation and try to create ruckus on the streets of Delhi. They were the ones who moved into the campus, and this is what the police version is, and this is up for people to investigate. The court should intervene and investigate the actions of the Delhi police.
Raghav Chadha is standing right next to you. Raghav, the bigger question though is that when you're looking at these protests today and the kind of, you know, they're not actually led by any political entity as such. I mean, it seems that politicians have become bystanders in this, which in a way is a good thing. And you have citizens coming forward and expressing their dissent about this act. Therefore, do you think that this was not anticipated by the government when it decided to ram this bill through?
Well, first of all, whether or not this was anticipated by the government of the day, this government believes that there is only one way to deal with a dissent, and that is by suppressing it. What we saw on the streets of Delhi a couple of days ago, what we saw near Jamia and in other parts of the city, is a classic example of how this government believes in dealing with those who do not subscribe to their way of thinking, who do not subscribe to their ideology. You have a student on the panel who's so articulately explained to us how police force, paramilitary forces, barged into the campus, released tear gas in libraries, vandalized the entire institution, beat up students. This is a criminal act. On top of it, the police, which was accusing the students of making the protest violent, has arrested 12 people as prime accused in the matter. Not even a single of them is a student of Jamia or is a student of any institution for that matter. The 12 people who have been arrested are not students. On the basis of what evidence did the police enter the institution? That's point number one. Point number two, there is an attempt by some people to make this entire controversy around CAA as a Hindu-Muslim issue. Initially, even some people in the media were portraying this as a Hindu-Muslim issue and showing AMU and Jamia as the areas where massive protests are taking place. But in the last 3 days, you have seen that it's not just limited to AMU and Jamia. From IIT Kharagpur to IIT Chennai to Madras, from IIM Ahmedabad to Oxford, Harvard, Yale, Columbia, across the globe, people who have some affinity with India are protesting on the streets. So therefore, it's not a Hindu-Muslim issue, number one. Number two, we boast when we speak on various platforms of coming from a country which is a market leader, which is the fastest growing internet country, which has the highest penetration of internet. And now we are living in a state where shutdown has been normalized, where shutting down of mobile connections, clampdown on internet has become a regular thing. I mean, yesterday I was reading this article which essentially explained that how from Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya to JNK, parts of UP, parts of Delhi, parts of Hyderabad, etc., which have been cut down from the entire communication system, and they translated that into the number of people who are without internet, which runs into several hundred millions.
Let me take what you said to Vivek Reddy of the BJP, who's joining us from Bangalore this evening. Mr. Reddy, would you concede that the state needs to find a better way to deal with people's dissent, to deal with the public's right to protest? And I know you're going to tell me people have a right to protest, but they shouldn't indulge in violence, and we completely agree with you. But I'm asking you, why were those people who were protesting peacefully also picked up and detained?
Well, I think, first of all, Lidhi, let's try to understand who were the perpetrators of violence first in the incident of Jamia Millia and in the incident of AMU. Particularly, Jamia Millia is now being orchestrated as a case of police atrocity. Who were the persons who committed the atrocities first? Let us try to understand that. It is on record that the students, it is now being said that outsiders were there, but students along with other outsiders had gone on to the streets and resorted to violence, arson. This is number one.
Who said the students resorted to arson?
Petrol was emptied from...
Allow me, Mr. Reddy.
We have to be very fact-specific and we have to understand the facts.
What is the source of your
facts? Because we can't...
No student has been arrested for any violence. So
the source of the facts...
Tell us the source of your facts.
The source of the facts are the media reports. Source of the facts are the media reports.
That's not true. Then they would have been arrested
for
that violence.
Who asked the protesters? Nidhi, tell me... Are you justifying, Nidhi, the act of taking petrol from two-wheelers and pouring it on public property and buses?
Reddy,
are you justifying that?
I said right at the beginning that violence is not justified at all.
Clear.
But there is no evidence that the students in Jamia were responsible for that. Firstly, you are not evading my question.
How do you say that?
Because the police have not arrested them. Police have not arrested the students
in
of Jamia.
Mob,
so how do you say the opposite? But Mr. Reddy, please answer my question. Specifically. Why was Ram Guha detained
it
yesterday?
Is not based on
what
the
was
arrest.
He doing? What was Ramchandra Guha doing in Bangalore that warranted
the
his
police
detention?
Please don't divert to Ramchandra Guha.
No.
I will come to Ramchandra Guha.
Ramchandra
Guha is the next case. Please, let us first complete Jamia Millia and then we'll come to Ramchandra Guha.
No. Mr. Reddy, this is not about...
Both these questions are
I'm asking you why people who were protesting peacefully were picked up. I'm asking you why people who were protesting peacefully were picked up by all
these... Please don't allow... One
yes.
second.
Yes.
One second, Nidhi. Nidhi, from the past 1 minute, you have asked me 2 questions. You have to allow me to answer both these questions. And my only request is that you bear me out patiently before
I will challenge you on facts.
That's
Mr.
the only
Reddy.
Request that
I'm
I
sorry, I will I challenge you on facts.
All right. You may challenge me on facts after I speak.
No,
please.
No, I will challenge you when
first
I like.
First of all, the first question
Thank
that I'd
much.
Like to ask the panelists is, I'd like to ask the panelists is taking petrol from two-wheelers and putting it on buses where passengers are there, is this
not
something
Nobody
of the most demonic
that.
Kind which cannot be accepted?
But,
and
what about
what,
the peaceful
What is wrong
protesters?
With the police in preventing this? And can you call this dissent or violence? Can you call
no.
this dissent
so
or arson?
I'm asking you about the
Isn't
thousands of people who have gathered in
this
Mumbai, in Bangalore, in Delhi, in other cities over the last couple of days who have done nothing but give roses to the police, who have not indulged in violence. That violence is condemnable, is absolutely...
Let me tell you what happens.
It's like saying, you know, it's like a motherhood and apple pie argument. Of course, violence is condemnable.
So
but
far
please
as,
tell me,
so far as Ramchandra
right.
Guha is concerned... Hmm. Let me just complete. So far as Ramchandra Guha is concerned, let me tell you, in all governments across all states, including Karnataka, wherever there is a protest and there is an imminent possibility that the protest is going to be violent due to huge numbers, there is a preventive arrest made. They are put into the buses and safely taken to a certain distance on the outskirts or somewhere, and they are left free. This is all that is done. This is being done against BJP men who stand in the protest. This is being done in previous past. This is being done in every other protest. This is a routine thing done by the government or done by the police. How can we say that this is stamping dissent? This is not stamping dissent.
Achha, this is
After
for their
the
safety.
Protest was culminated, in oh. order to ensure that there is law and order, this is done as a preventive measure. This happens every
yeah,
other day.
But you
day.
Know what?
This
because in the name of preventive,
followed
in
by the
name of preventive measures, we've seen a lot of things that have been justified in the name of security and preventive measures. And I just want to get Mr. Danish Ali also into this debate.
I think
He's
you must first
MP
be
of
holding
the
a TV
he was
show.
Your political colleague
the talking
in
point of the TV show must be: why is there a resort to violence? Who is
no.
instigating this violence?
No, no, no. You want to divert it only to the violence,
point.
But Mr. Reddy,
because,
I'm not going to let you do that.
Because we are a nation
because
which
there is a bigger story here, and those are
we
the peaceful
are
protests that are happening.
Peace.
Violence is
People
not justified.
Not be
Mr. Danish Ali,
to
these are
violence.
Preventive arrests, these are preventive measures, because you know we anticipate something may happen, so let's not let it happen.
Nidhi, first of all, I must answer what Mr. Vivek Reddy is saying. He and his leaders doesn't know the history of Jamia Millia Islamia. Jamia Millia Islamia is a product of non-cooperation movement. Can he answer why the Delhi police entered the library? Why they have brutally beaten the students who were preparing for their civil services exams? Does he have any answer for that? And Mr. Reddy, only few footages are out. The full footage of the brutality in Jamia Millia Islamia has been submitted to the government by the Vice Chancellor. And some of them are with us also.
India
you don't worry. Everything will come out.
Please talk and responsibly, sir.
No, who is responsible?
India is not such
who
a
is responsible?
Where people commit arson and violence.
Honorable
and
Prime Minister says
the
violence, violent people who are making violence can be identified with their clothes.
You have
the same
no,
way as
you
it has been
no
identified yesterday in Bengal, in
You
Mushidabad.
Are not talking about the violence. You are not saying
the way in which...
One second, I want to get Bhumika to comment on this. Yes, Bhumika.
I just want to address this to sir. Sir, your talking point has always been violence. Fun. Please get more talking points to talk on the news channel right now. My point number two is that I, on behalf of Jamia Millia Islamia and all my friends who had been peacefully protesting outside of the university, we condemn any kind of violence that happened. And I can assure you, none of my friends, nobody, all of us, we did not indulge in any violence at all. We are the ones who made posters about nobody should indulge in violence. And all my friends, believe me, all my friends have not indulged in any sort of violence. Point number two, you have, as soon as the anchor asked you the first question, the first thing you did was this. You started by saying, who committed the atrocities first? Sir, atrocities first or second does not matter. Atrocities are atrocities. Why do you compound or boil down the debate to who committed it first and who committed second? What has happened wrong. Okay, why, I want to ask from you, why did you give orders to Delhi police to do what they did in our campus? Why did you tell them to tear gas our libraries? You should read reports which says that tear gas should not be put in or applied in closed confined spaces. If you would be here, if you would be in my campus that day, you would also be running for your life. Also, my last point is this, that, the way you say, who these people who committed the crimes first and, all these people, believe me, my friends who were sitting in the library who had nothing to do with the protest, even they are going to have the impact of this incident for all their life. It's going to traumatize them. And believe me, you have no idea how badly my friends have been traumatized. All right, I just want to make it clear to you. And don't boil down the debate to violence first. Please deal with the question. We're talking about how your government should deal with dissent. Please answer this.
Mr. Reddy?
Yes. Let me tell you one thing. It is very easy to, split up and say that we did not do anything. Why did the police enter? It's a very easy argument. I think it's an escapist argument. This is not the way you responsibly, talk or debate about an issue. When outside your campus and inside your campus there has been violence, somebody has to bear responsibility for it. You simply cannot say outsiders did it and we are not responsible. Well, is that the way, the system works? Violence is prohibited in India. You have resorted to, I am not saying the student, but whoever has done it has resorted to the most cheap means. The most outrageous means. How could are you just saying that you're not responsible? Somebody did it and then. Well, there were students there. There were students there. Jamia Millia students had congregated in huge numbers.
Enter the library.
You could have used water tanks.
We're all talking at the same time.
Can I just get Zeeshan? Don't talk in between. Bhumika, please understand.
Can I get Zeeshan?
Have you done something to cooperate with the police and give the names to the police?
Did you use water cannons on the crowd?
Nothing has been done.
Did you use water cannons?
But you know what I find? What I find starkly, I'm sorry to say, what I find starkly missing in this conversation is any empathy, any empathy at all with the people's right to protest and the genuine anguish of students, across the board. Zeeshan, I just want you to comment on that. I mean, what we needed was a government. I think it was very important if the government is saying that it wants to listen to what the students have to say, then they should try to reach out to civil societies, to students and have a genuine dialogue, not put out things in the media through anonymous sources. What do you think, Zeeshan?
Yeah, I think that is what they've been doing from a very long. I think the whole propaganda of just making a narrative that suits them, and then they just try and pitch that you also mentioned that there were no students involved in violence, and I'm sure as Bhumika is saying, jo log library mein the, they were not at all, they were not even maybe involved in the protest, but the way they treated them, I think it was completely inhuman, and I think even they know that is why they are covering it up. The way students were treated, the way they tear gassed into the library, and they were beating people in hostels and everywhere, because I've been there for 2 days and I've seen what they have done to that beautiful campus. So I think they also know that. That is why they just keep on making new narratives and just yahan pe in logon ne yahan shuru kiya, and then maybe some other area they are taking up, and they are just trying to divert from the main topic. And I think that is what they generally do. And when you know that you are at fault, this is what you do.
Is that what is happening, Rajat? That the whole focus is going to the violent protest, and we're losing sight of a bigger.
No, I am going to come to the bigger picture also. Nidhi, you need to understand. See, let me not get into specific examples, but you also know there was a video which was put out by Delhi police, which said that when they were inside the campus, at that very time, tube light broke and tube lights were thrown, stones were being thrown. So there were definitely miscreants, and I'm not alleging the students of Jamia at all, but there were miscreants inside the university campus which were dealt with. And let the courts of the of our country decide what was right, what was wrong. Let the panelists not do that job for the court. Now that is number one. Number two, water cannons and all, it's a very simple thing. Madhya Pradesh government has imposed 144 in 44 districts out of 50 districts, yeah. odd districts in, yeah. in Madhya Pradesh. And yeah. they're using water cannons on BJP supporters also. So water cannon is a small thing. It's a part and parcel of protests in India.
That's what I'm saying.
All.
That's what I'm saying. Water cannons should have been, yeah, you know, you water can ban should it. Have so, been thrown instead of tear gas.
No, no, absolutely.
Instead of tear gas. Tear gas would, is, instead of beating us, water cannons
no,
should
no.
have been.
See, beating you, I will never agree to anybody beating the students
my
out there.
I'm injury, sir.
I am fully, my full empathy is with you. But also keep it in mind who are the real culprits behind this entire nuisance factor
coming
that is going
back,
on in the streets.
Coming back, why not
Bhumika,
water? Why
Bhumika,
tear gas?
Empathy-wise, I am fully with you. Now, let me address the critical question, which is the question which needs to be addressed by the politicians of the day. Do you know what Amanatullah Khan, who is an MLA of the Aam Aadmi Party, whose representative here was taking a moral high ground?
Sir, one,
do you know what he said?
Thing?
No, let me complete my point, Bhumika. He said that because of, please let me complete my point, Raghav,
yeah.
you have already climbed several stairs
so
of moral ground.
Answer,
he said,
finish.
No, 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 there is absolute, no, no, please, Bhumika, I have heard you, you have to hear me out. He said, ye log aaj cab lekar aaye hain, kal ye log, are rukiye sahab, main aapko video dikhaunga national television pe. Ye log bolte hain, aaj ye log azan nahi karne denge aapko, aaj cab band kiya, kal azan band kar denge, fir loudspeaker band kar denge, fir humko sar ke topi nahi pehenne denge, hamari daadiyan chhilwa denge. या अमानतुल्लाह खान मैं मानता हूं कि दिल्ली पुलिस को अगर किसी को पकड़ना चाहिए था तो वो अमानतुल्लाह खान को जेल में डालना चाहिए था. इस आदमी ने माहौल बना दिया इस देश का, इस देश की सुरक्षा के साथ खेल रहा है, इस देश के हितों के साथ खेल रहा है, वो इस पार्टी का नुमाइंदा है. यहां खड़े हुए और ये मॉरल हाईग्राउंड इन बच्चों के हितों के साथ खेला है, इन बच्चों के भविष्यों के साथ खेला है ऐसे गुंडों ने. इन गुंडों को जेल में भरना चाहिए. आप तथ्य को समझिए, ये लोग ना, ये लोग पॉलिटिशियंस ऑफ ऑल ह्यूज एंड कलर्स कैन नॉट टेक लीडरशिप, स्पेशली दे कैन नॉट टेक मॉरल लीडरशिप, स्पेशली ऑन सच इश्यूज व्हिच आर सच डीपली डिवाइसिव
इश्यूज. इफ ही हैज सेड दैट, यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट, इट अमाउंट्स टू इंसाइटमेंट. वन सेकंड, वुड यू ऑल्सो अग्री that the Karnataka minister today, a minister in Karnataka who called for, you know, a reaction similar to post Godhra among Hindus, should also be taken
absolutely
to task?
Put them behind the bars. I'm with them. But anybody, okay. मैं मानता हूँ कि जामिया के अगर building के ऊपर खिलाफत 2.0 लिखा गया है. I'm sure none of the students of Jamia have written खिलाफत 2.0. They have not said तेरा मेरा रिश्ता क्या लाहे लाहे लिला. These slogans are not being written by Jamia students, but who are writing it? We should get to the bottom of that and identify this miscreant.
Yamini Aiyar first and then Raghav. Okay, Yamini first.
I think this entire conversation is proof of one simple fact. The government brought in a law that is deeply polarizing without any debate. Yes. One day in parliament, and we ran through a law. We have protests, and you think that you can address the protests through brute force. That has brought us to a place where we are having this conversation. We should not be in a place where we are having this conversation. India is a deeply secular country. When you start playing with that core of what makes this country, you end up in a place of deep division. And that is something that we should be very worried about. And that is something that we should be in a position to dialogue with the government about. The fact that instead we have brute force and a close off of space of dialogue and difficulty to protest peacefully is a sign of what dangerous territory we are in India today.
Okay, Raghav Chadha, now you can respond.
There are a few quick points. First of all, I am a civilized person who believes in participating
on
in civilized conversations.
You are not a civilized person.
I neither
do not
engage
take moral
with
high ground
uncivilized
on
persons, nor do I engage. Nor do I engage in any uncivilized conversation.
He used an uncivilized
word
and he should
so
retract on that.
You see, I can only respond to the...
You're repeating it. Why are you repeating it?
First of all,
we are repeating it.
In a very civil...
Unprecedented situation.
In an extremely civil way, I will certainly say that what was said on your channel in an extremely charged, emotional way is utter nonsense, is dirty propaganda and is nothing short of bullshit. A. B. If Amanatullah Khan, if an MLA of the Aam Aadmi Party, if the MLA of the Aam Aadmi Party, if the MLA of the Aam Aadmi Party has engaged in anything,
there have to be certain limits on what can be uttered and what cannot be uttered. Nidhi, you have to maintain the decorum of this platform. You have to maintain the decorum. I will not tolerate the insult like this.
Then don't tolerate. Oh,
please shut up.
Do not tolerate.
I have my freedom of expression over here.
Don't tolerate. No, I know how you tolerate. I know how you tolerate this.
You need to set the decorum of this panel.
But if the decorum, you are the one who should maintain the decorum. If you are not doing that, Nidhi, then you are being partial. Then I have to walk out of the debate. You decide what is the decorum.
First of all, if Amanatullah Khan of the Aam Aadmi Party made certain statements which are being alleged, then why hasn't Amanatullah Khan been arrested? Why hasn't he not been named in the FIR? The BJP for the last 1 week has been shouting from the roof that Amanatullah Khan is the reason why there was violence in Jamia. Amanatullah Khan at the time of violence was miles away from the site of violence addressing a peaceful gathering in the presence of Delhi police personnel, number one. Number two, I am making a very serious and a categorical statement on your show, which is that in 2015, 60 days prior to the then Delhi Assembly elections, similar communal flagrations were seen in areas of Trilokpuri and Bhavana, engineered, orchestrated by the BJP. One. Similar situations are being witnessed.
Disproved.
May I complete
the
now?
The church attacks was disproved.
May I respond now?
Church attacks were a fanciful creation of the Aam Aadmi Party just to win the election.
Are we discussing proposed Delhi Assembly elections or the CA?
It's only fair because an accusation was made. Let Raghav finish and then let's move on to the bigger issue here.
I am again reiterating that it is an act of violence which has been engineered by certain people to polarize the electorate and communalize the entire environment in Delhi, number one. Number two, if Amanatullah Khan or any MLA of the Aam Aadmi Party has made certain statements, why hasn't he not been arrested?
Okay,
who does the Delhi police report
to?
Number one,
Yamini.
Number two, let me just finish, Nidhi. Since we are discussing an act of violence in Delhi and the police brutalities, let me remind you that as per India's constitution, Delhi police as well as law and order in Delhi falls under no state government, but directly under Mr. Amit Shah. And ever since Amit Shah has become the Home Minister,
Delhi
police
brutalities have increased. Delhi law and order.
And lastly, just give me 15 more seconds. I'm not making any political statement. 15 more seconds. As per a landmark judgment of the Punjab Haryana High Court in the year 1979, Dayal Singh judgment, the High Court laid down certain prerequisites which need to be followed and which need to be tested before the brute force of the state can be unleashed. Those conditions are, number one, that there needs to be an unlawful assembly. Number two, that unlawful assembly is there with the objective of committing violence. Number three, an appeal needs to be made to that unlawful assembly to disperse. And number four, if these three conditions are met and the unlawful assembly does not disperse, it is only in that scenario can the Delhi police unleash violence. Can you please explain?
So I want to ask you,
I
will come back to you.
Were those who were quietly sitting in the library of Jamia, was that an unlawful assembly with the intent of committing violence?
Okay, Yamini, the question is, I want to focus on the bigger issue here, which is the question of allowing dissent to be expressed, right? Now, the thing is, the debate keeps getting digressed to the issue of violent protests, which are, of course, an issue. We have seen the way policemen were attacked in Gujarat yesterday. We have seen violent flare-ups today in many towns in UP, and that is not acceptable. So how do you sort of, you know, counter that argument that the state is using, that this is what we want to avoid, and hence we blocked the roads from Gurgaon to Delhi yesterday, we have swooped in and, you know, imposed prohibitory orders, because that seems to be what is being used against every other peaceful protest that is happening.
Look, there is no question that violence has to be condemned and violence has to be contained. There is absolutely no question. That is a given. It is the responsibility of the state to ensure that it does a careful assessment and makes that assessment public before it starts imposing things like Section 144, before it does mobile phone and internet shutdowns, and before it starts doing the harsh things like tear gassing, which is why, as Raghav rightly pointed out, there are very clear protocols of what needs to be put in place. The fact of the matter is that preventive anticipation is always a very grey area, and it is used consistently by the state to impose its brute force, as it did yesterday in Delhi. There was nothing to indicate that yesterday in Delhi would be violent. In fact, the protests went on through the day, and from everything I saw and read,
it was absolutely peaceful. So the fact that the state uses elements of what is of power that are given to the state, which are necessary to protect citizens against citizens, is something that we must question and ask.
So Rajat, can I ask you that a point that actually Raghav made earlier and many have made in the last couple of days, India aspiring to be, you know, a major, a superpower, has the maximum number of internet shutdowns. Is this how the state, you think, should respond to every law and order situation?
Well, Nidhi, let me address Yamini ji's point first. Yamini ji said that there has to be imminent threat, there are certain preconditions. Why did she assume or presume this fact that the police of UP, MP, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, and in Delhi have not followed those due processes? That's a big assumption. I am pretty confident, and it has been proven by all the flare-ups in UP that have happened today, that their perception of the imminent threat that was being posed to both life and to property was actually correct. So they went through all the processes, and they could, I mean, see, you need to also understand that if they do not impose 144, they do not take precautionary measure, who will take the responsibility if there are any deaths? I am rather happy that only very, very few could be whose lives were lost. Barring those, it was controlled. Ultimately, we did not lose many lives. There could be hundreds who could have lost lives. Who will take the responsibility of that? See, this happens.
Where is the evidence
where
of that?
Is look the at evidence?
No, that, you this saw what I'm saying.
You saw see, the protests in Mumbai yesterday. You know, the thousands of people that came at
Yeah, absolutely. See, every state is different.
No, so, but where is the evidence? Yes, just take with the city you live in. Where is the evidence that yesterday morning there was going to be violence in Lalkila?
The executive magistrate.
Where is the evidence that Mandi House was going to be violent? Where is the evidence that resulted in an internet mobile shutdown in parts of the city? See, where is the evidence?
Is a, there is
and
a
it is incumbent on the state to
there is
take
a quasi-judicial
such
body.
To put that evidence
who is the
out
executive
in the
magistrate?
Domain.
Who is the district the executive magistrate who needs to take this into account and analyze as to is there imminent threat? It is up to him because he is that quasi-judicial body who takes
which
that call.
Which is exactly where you end up. So, which is a grey area.
No, fair
which
enough,
is
it is a grey area.
Which
you,
is why when
which
is why the
changed,
state has to be
to
extremely
to
careful about what
fair
about
but
how
see,
it uses
largely
its force. You know what is
great
today?
This is not a normal fair.
Today the Karnataka High Court has actually said even though this section 144 is going to end, I think tomorrow, the 3-day period, they're going to look at the legality and whether, you know, fundamental rights were violated by
absolutely
having this blanket section 144. There are still some courts in this country
and
who have shown a spine. I mean, it's the Guwahati High Court that has ensured that the internet got restored after 10 days in Assam. But, you know, Zeeshan, again, a bigger question. What do you think the fact that, you know, ordinary citizens are part of these protests, what is the bigger message you think that they are sending out there? What is the real messaging here? Zeeshan, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sorry, I was asking you that what do you think is the bigger message that ordinary citizens are sending out by taking part in these protests? We haven't seen protests like this in a very long time.
Yeah, I think it's quite clear that India has understood what they are trying to do. I think the whole time, even right now in this discussion, they are trying to make it a Hindu-Muslim issue. They are because that is the only narrative that they can sell and they can get their vote bank or whatever, I don't know. But I think everybody is coming out because we have understood that it's a non-secular thing and it is against the idea of India. And that is why they are not talking about the way people turned up yesterday for the protest in all of India. So I think it's quite a clear statement that we cannot accept anything and everything that you हमारे ऊपर जो थोपा जाएगा, we will resist and we will talk about the correct idea of India and a country, a secular country, first of all.
Bhumika.
I would like to say very, very clearly that sir right here who's trying to politicize the issue on the basis of religion by talking about certain graffitis in Jamia Millia Islamia. I just want to say, sir, this is not an issue we want to politicize. Very clearly, students of Jamia, I am a Hindu and I am against CAA. And a lot of people from my college who belong to various religion are against CAA and All India NRC. And not just students of Jamia, but students of JNU Ambedkar University, University, IITs, IIMs, a lot of, you know, and not just universities. Generally, people across India are against CAA and All India NRC. And that is why people are coming out and standing against this. And they just want to voice out their opinions. People are coming out without any stones. People are coming out without their people. You saw what happened on Sunday. Like, people just, you know, we just wanted to go to Lal Killa or Mandi House just to, you know, bring out a larger message that we do not support the bill. That is the only thing we all are trying to do. All the people who are protesting here. I think I want to make that thing very, very, very clear. Apart from that, the metro stations that are being closed, it's not, we just don't go to the protests. So we go to do other things also. We go to our other works also. There are families, there are friends we need to attend. You just can't close stations like this. Day to night, Jamia. Okay, understandable that protests are happening at Jamia, so you close Jamia. You close Munirka, sir. Like, just because there is JNU near Munirka, you close Munirka. I mean, you close n number of metro stations without any reason, just because people are going to assemble in protest, are going to say that, oh, we don't support this bill. I think people, I am so glad to see so many other people coming out and saying this fact.
You know what? Actually, what Bhumika said is very important. Rajat, I'll come to you in a second, because she's made the point that this is not a Hindu-Muslim issue.
Exactly.
You are seeing people from across religions who have a problem with the citizenship bill. It's not about one community. I want to ask Mr. Vivek Reddy this, though. Mr. Reddy, you would have seen, like the rest of us have, this entire year, pretty much, the massive protests that have taken place in Hong Kong. China is an authoritarian state. And yet, even the mighty China allowed protests to take place every weekend, with those protesters even managing to shut down the airport of Hong Kong for several days, which was, you know, unthinkable. But, you know, they didn't impose Section 140, whatever they may have, which is an equivalent. They allowed those peaceful protests to take place. So what is the problem with India allowing that? We're not an authoritarian China. We are the world's largest democracy. If China can allow peaceful protests in Hong Kong, what is the problem in India allowing peaceful protests in its cities?
Well, I'm amused that at every instance we compare ourselves to foreign countries and say, if those countries are doing that, what is the problem with us? We have a beautiful constitution. The constitution says that people have rights. It also says people have duties. And one of the duties is Article 51A,
that you are trying to destroy the constitution.
That citizens shall not resort to violence. Citizens should not resort to violence.
I am not
please
asking
learn,
you about
sir,
citizens who are resorting to violence.
People are out on the streets. You are trying to destroy the constitution.
You keep deflecting it.
First
you
of
please
all,
answer the question about peaceful protests. And the reason why one is... you
so
don't hesitate in comparing
peaceful,
yourself to China on so many other things.
So
my point is China
is
not a democracy. And yet it allows peaceful protests. We are a democracy.
Protest was totally peaceful.
Why is every protest
Protest was totally peaceful.
Why is every protest ending in violence?
But it's
you
not.
Should ask that question.
Every protest is not.
Must be.
Mr. Reddy, every protest has not ended in violence. That is a factually incorrect statement.
It's not a question of violence. People are protesting. People are out on
this
the street to save the constitution of
you
India.
You should not resort to violence.
People can accept anything, but people will not tolerate if there is an attack on the constitution of India. That is why people are out on the street.
Because I can't get through to him otherwise. Mr. Reddy,
first and foremost, be peaceful in your protest.
People have been. You are factually incorrect in saying that every protest has ended violently. It has not. So I am asking, why is the Indian
almost
state
every.
So afraid of peaceful
almost
protests?
Almost every.
Sir, I'd like to no, almost you. Every is not correct.
Sir, after we are 15, not afraid of any people's protest.
Sir, after
yes.
15.
We are not afraid of any people's protest.
Sir, after 15,
anybody
every
wants
in front
to
of Jamia,
peaceably
we
protest
have been protesting.
Are permitted.
After 15,
unfortunately,
not after 15, before 15,
people
every
like
day
Bhumika
we have been protesting.
Have
even today we
have
protests which have a very
the other
peaceful.
Panelists have very different perception.
So yesterday,
first
yesterday
of all,
it was a
please understand. Much of
and
India
we had a very
used to this legislation.
I am coming to protest today.
Much of India wants to protest. The major part of India agrees to this legislation.
But you should not
they want this legislation very badly.
Sir, okay. I am straight coming from protest.
But
okay, it has been completely peaceful.
Basically, what Danish Ali is saying is very important.
See, there was
the
violence. I condemn
UP
my party
yeah.
totally condemns any kind of violence. In a civilized society, there is no place for the violence at all. But
The people who are sitting on a responsible position, whether it's a chief minister of UP or a home minister or prime minister, they should have a restraint in reacting to that. Yesterday, what chief minister said? Hum iska badla lenge. Arre, you are the chief minister. You should tell the people of the, assure the people of the
you
state that all these perpetrators will be brought to justice.
Property.
To
UP, sir.
They will
you
be brought to justice. Not the badle ki
bhavna
se.
He has to warn the protesters and tell them.
Please don't go to violence.
What sort of thinking is this? What sort of debate is this?
Chief minister of a state.
I'm actually going to give the last
one. I think there is a problem in your mindset. The
no, it's a problem in your mindset, in your organizational mindset. People have heard how the government was responding. Even when I was sitting in the parliament, the way in which the Honorable Home Minister was addressing, it was nothing but totally a divisive agenda they were unleashing.
Can I ask last question to each of you first to Raghu?
There is no such
would
divisive
you concede,
agenda.
Okay,
you have a divisive agenda
no
to destroy the constitution of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. You want to destroy the
this
constitution
your,
given
okay, gentlemen, one second. I just have 3 minutes
you
left.
You want to destroy the idea of India.
Through
you
this,
want to,
through
you want
blaming,
to destroy the pluralistic
this blaming
society
game
in this
of
country.
Politics, we know.
Okay, guys,
you
one second, gentlemen, please.
Please understand, this is a legislation.
And that is why we were opposing this bill from the day one.
It is a valid piece
my
of
leader has said
okay.
from the day
that
one.
Is, that
it
is, would you concede? Okay, one second,
don't.
One second.
That is why the BSP has voted against
sorry,
the bill in both the House of Parliament.
Do you think
that very sad that you don't have pity?
The government did not anticipate the anger to the Citizenship Act for whatever reason. And that maybe it is better going, I mean, you know, the 370 revocation happened hours before and was rammed through parliament. You know, that this shouldn't have been done in that way.
Not
that there
all.
Needed
this
to be more.
Vidhi,
you
Vidhi,
have an all party
understand.
Meeting.
No.
Have call everybody,
fair
sit
enough.
Together and get their
see,
inputs.
I think it's a communication problem. Government realizes and therefore they have gone on a spree to explain to people what is there. Largely, people have understood that CAA is not the real issue. The real issue is CAA
plus
NRC,
right?
We also agree, and therefore, when NRC is something that is still not even discussed, the rules, bylaws, nothing has been discussed. This is open for discussion.
When
of course, they are going
the
to reach
CAA
out.
Was discussed in Lok Sabha. The Honourable
Home Minister
was referring. We will bring NRC. We will bring NRC. Don't worry, we will bring NRC.
You also know, being a member of Parliament, you very well know that NRC. No, not at all. You should go by what is officially put out on the table, either tabled in the Parliament or otherwise. He is saying NRC. He has said. But how do you?
In the Parliament,
absolutely, I stick by what he has said. He has said. Has he said? Has
he
laid down
certain things in the Parliament?
Please let me explain. I know you are riled up because of what has happened at JNU campus. Sorry, Jamia campus. So let me explain. He has put out that there will be no similar exercise as what Assam people have gone through. He said it will be like a simple thing. And this clarification has also been put out. No way has the rules been framed as to how complicated will it be, or will it be religious centered, or trying to attack or target a specific religion. NRC will not discriminate at all. This is an assurance given by the Prime Minister. Let me give you one final point. Muslims in Coimbatore have come out. They have said the Prime Minister Modi has given a clarification to me.
Guys,
I just want to say two very important things. Number one, it is very dangerous territory to try and start decoupling Citizenship Amendment and NRC. Citizenship Amendment Act in and of itself is deeply, deeply polarizing. Okay. It fundamentally undermines the constitutional ethos of secularism by introducing religion as a marker of citizenship and citizenship pathways. Secondly, to the point that Rajat made about the NRC being not as torturous as the NRC in Assam, in a deeply undocumented and poorly capacitated state like India, it is impossible to do. There is no way by which you can do the NRC without rendering.
I want to just give
it doesn't matter. Put NRC aside. CAA is fundamentally undermining our constitutional ethos. Don't forget that.
I just want to say one thing. Do we not believe what our Home Minister unfortunately says in the Parliament, you know, standing up straight that hum NRC karenge and all of those
NRC
things.
Second
of all, the in UP what is happening is very, very, very dangerous. I have friends who have gone back to home in UP. They're scared to upload tweets stating, you know, tweets in support of the protest. Because the UP government is, you know, cracking down, you know, targeting students by who,
you
know,
know
who upload WhatsApp.
Let
me complete. This is one more thing. Second of fall, like this is happening in UP and it's really, really dangerous. If my friends are afraid whether or not they upload, should upload certain tweets or not, it's really very
I'll
dangerous.
Tell you,
people have been asked to open their phones to see whether or not they have videos from Jamia Islamia or not. Second thing. Third thing, I'm really fortunate that I live in Delhi because I can at least come out in support of what I believe in. In UP, if I would at least, you know, tweet something, people would come to my house.
I'll just respond really quickly. Yeah. But this is what a tweet, you know, when people trying to fabricate and spread fake news, they targeted me that I was spreading petrol in canister cans to burn the buses, and I was in a hospital. This is a tweet which had 1,200 retweets, Nidhi. This is not a small thing. The tweet said, let me repeat, such fake news were going around, and it is targeting me when I was in the hospital. I had a minor surgery which I had to go in, and the tweet said, today at 2:45 p.m., South Delhi MP Buduri, along with Rajat Sethi and Meenakshi Lekhi, gathered 50 to 100 people to burn the buses down. But this is what, this has 1,200 retweets.
I'm really sorry, I have to take a break. I'm really sorry. Thank you very much to all of you for joining us. Oh my goodness, what a week this has been. Thanks for joining us. Good night.